All right, here goes nothing. Let's see. So first and foremost, the final exam is next Thursday. And just in case you missed it, we actually had to look it up today. It is in this room. So it is not in some special final exam room. The way we're doing it though, go to the next slide. So the exam's in two parts. There's a written part. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna bring a laptop. Make sure you start a Jupyter Notebook before the exam. Make sure it actually launches, all that other stuff. Bring your laptop with you. Try to make sure it's charged. So hopefully that you will have plenty of battery for the life of it. But what you're gonna do is you're gonna kind of come in, make sure you spread out a little bit. So let's say, make sure there's at least two seats in between each person and that you're not immediately behind somebody. So try to offset, right? You're gonna get the written portion. We'll either hand it out or we'll probably wanna hand it out. That'll probably be the easiest. So you write the written stuff down. And then once you're done with that, you're gonna come and turn the written part in. And then you're gonna go back to wherever you were sitting, and then you can take out your computer. So your computer should be in your bag or on the floor or something like that during the written portion. Then take out your computer and we'll have instructions. I'll probably put them up on a slide here for exactly how to get to the kind of Jupyter side of the thing. This is me hoping that we can give you a problem set that you can work on a computer so we don't have the challenges that we had with the programming on paper problem last time. Let's see. We'll talk about what's in the content in a second. But you know, in short, it's going to cover the whole semester, but really it's covering the whole semester because everything kind of builds, right? So, you know, kind of real specific questions, it'll be mostly about since the midterm, you know, but, you know, as I think I said in another lecture, you know, if there's, you know, you're going to be using table, right? Like, even though you learned it early, there's no way around it. All right. Any questions so far? One sec. All right, any other questions? All right, nice segue. Oh, not quite, actually, in a minute. All right, a couple things. If you're unable to attend the final exam, please contact both Graham and myself by Thursday this week. If it's a preference, it is unlikely that we will accommodate it. You know, if you just, you know, you don't like doing stuff on Thursdays, we're unlikely to accommodate. If you have a direct conflict, okay, or you have, you know, or some really strong reason, the problem is, right, is that if you miss it, that means I have to produce another test, okay? So I would really rather not do that unless I'm already doing one because somebody has a really hard reason. And then, as we said, for the midterm accommodations, please let us know by Thursday just so we can actually deal with them. If you are unfamiliar with what constitutes a disability or what the accommodations are, go to the website, look it up. Feel free to just ask. I don't think we had anyone for the midterm. So, you know, my expectation is we're not going to see anyone this time. But if you have any concerns or problems or whatever, either shoot us an email, come to my office hours, just let us know what we can do. All right. As far as the content is concerned, I struggle a little bit with how to write some of these, but, you know, so as we did on the midterm and comes up a lot is the graphs. So I would say that's something that's a little bit before the midterm, but we're still using them a lot now. So the kind of which graph for what scenario is likely on the test. And then sampling. Okay, so when I say method here, what I'm trying to say is like, know how to go about doing a sample. Okay, and what it means to do good sampling. Bootstrapping, same, okay? Know what the difference is between sampling and bootstrapping, okay? And how you approach bootstrapping, what is the method for doing it, okay? So the reason I'm kind of pointing these out in particular is because these are the kinds of things that would be in the Jupyter Notebook portion of the test primarily, right? It's gonna say, I want you to answer some question in order to answer that question, you may have to do sampling, you may have to do bootstrapping, et cetera. You know, so kind of think of it almost like as one of, similar to one of the homeworks. Actually, I have some examples in a minute, but like similar to a homework or a lab, whatever. Confidence intervals, you should be aware of what they are and what they mean, and how to calculate them. Standard deviation, again, this is kind of, this one was a little weird where I get a little confused about the right term here, but like a part of creating standard deviations is a formula, but it's also kind of a method. So like, how do you get to standard deviation? What are they for? Why do you use them? Correlation, same. Nearest neighbor method, okay? So how do you do nearest neighbor predictions? Then linear regression as well. In particular, the slope, intercept, and line formulas, okay? That those will be useful. And then root mean square error and residuals. We covered part of this topic last time, and we're covering the rest today. And then we're going to do a bit of ethics on Thursday, and anything else, and kind of any review stuff that I'm going to kind of catch up from the last, call it 4 or 5 lectures. So that's why you haven't seen those yet, because we haven't actually covered them in lecture yet. Does it make sense to everyone? Any questions? All right. So here's the kind of practicum portion. Sorry, somebody say something, or am I hearing voices in my head again? All right. So if you haven't looked at homework 9 yet, homework 9 is about predicting the number of warplanes that Germany had in World War II. What you're doing in that homework, I would say, is very similar to what you would be expected to do for one of these practicum, for the practicum part of the final exam. Here are some questions that you might be asked to answer, in a sense, okay? I am telling you about these beforehand, so feel free if you wanna do any research or whatever, but I've talked about the blue bike stuff. Trash cans, there's a bunch of data about Boston and what are called the big belly trash cans. You've probably seen them around, but they're like solar powered and they do trash compacting. So how likely is it that there's a trash can near a blue bike dock? Okay, so basically it's a prediction, right, based on some sort of data. How fast can you expect a 311 request to be acted upon? Does everybody here know what a 311 request is? Anyone here? Okay, so Boston, like many cities in the US, but mostly big cities, you're all familiar with 911, right? Okay, so 911 is basically who you call for emergency. 311 traditionally used to be who you called if there's like a street light out. Okay, so like you want to kind of say there's something wrong, right, that you need fixed. A big use of that actually is sharps collection. So, you know, if you see a needle, there's somebody to call so that it gets collected before some stupid kid wanders by it. That number always used to be 311. I have no idea if the phone number works anymore, but now there's there's a Twitter and there's an app and a bunch of stuff like that. So Boston makes the 311 data public, largely. So how fast can you expect 311 requests to be acted upon? Might be another question. And then which Boston neighborhood has the most construction? So another thing that happens, or another thing is published about Boston, and is actually published, I think it's actually required by most law, but permitting. So if you've ever seen a sign up that says, you know, or had to go get one about a moving permit, for example, that's a kind of permit. One of the other kinds of permits is construction permits. So you could theoretically figure out which neighborhoods in Boston have the most construction based on looking at what permits have been requested for construction in each neighborhood. These all make sense? Okay, so these are the kinds of questions that I would be proposing or something along these lines for the computer part of the final exam. All right, cool. I am talking through this a little bit faster than I expected, but I guess that's good because we had some technical difficulties. All right, so how to study. I would definitely take a look at the midterm review guides. I thought they were quite good, and they certainly can't hurt. Any notes that you have taken, And then I have posted all of the lecture videos that I have. Obviously, we haven't posted today's, for example. But everyone that I have is up at that playlist. And Graham will post the slides in a few minutes, so you can pull the link instead of trying to type it in. There's at least one that is missing its audio, unfortunately. So that is sad, but technical fail. And then the lecture notebooks, I'm going to push the notebooks probably this evening, but we'll post a Piazza when they're up. And was that the, does that answer your question? You meant the notebooks, right? Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so now we're going to do something that you might have already been doing this so far. So there's a course eval, okay? And we are supposed to leave the room while you do this. I don't know, who can we voluntell to come and get us in 15 minutes or something so that you have time to fill it out without us breathing down your neck? Feel free to raise your hand. Otherwise, I'm going to pick someone who is unlucky and probably not on crutches. I meant to give this a little backstory. Has anybody done any of these yet? Yeah, okay. Well, your information is on them, but I don't see it. Okay, so it is private in that sense, but you know, the university can get to it. So, you know, swearing at university administration, probably not the best choice. But I don't see it, right? All I see is kind of the output. So, you know, please fill that out. And we'll, like I said, we'll give you 15 minutes to do it and then come back and continue. I'm going to pause the video. All right, so who wants to volunteer to come get us? Oh, all right, cool. But let me pause the recording. All right, so everyone's done? Cool. All right. So kind of getting into the actual content of the class today. We talked a little bit about the correlation coefficient, R. R is just really commonly used, so just, you know, try very hard to remember that's what R means. You see it in a lot of, you know, kind of anything that you see kind of with statistics on the internet, etc. So it's just important to remember that's what it stands for. So remember, it's a range between 1 and negative 1, with 0 indicating that there's no only linear association. So they may still have an association, it just isn't a linear one. But you do know that it does not have a linear one. This is the scatter plot of what it looks like when you have an R that's 0. There's a negative here somewhere. So a negative kind of goes down this way, like this, right? And so that's a negative 0.5. And so you can see it's still pretty blobby, right? But it's definitely starting to look like a line. And then you have something that's real close to 1 here, so that's going up and to the right. Okay. As I mentioned before, in business, sometimes referred to as the hockey stick, you know, you always want your revenue going up and to the right. So that's the correlation coefficient. And here's how you compute it. What you're trying to do, why is this not stretching? What you're trying to do is convert it all to standard units. So first you convert X and Y to standard units. Then you take the product of the standard deviations of those values. And then the average of the values, right? The standard units are to get rid of the weirdness of differences between units so that you can so things are more comparable. You know, and so that some of the calculations work. So that's important. X and Y are technically interchangeable. However, be very careful when you do that and remember what you did, because, you know, the correlations and, you know, kind of all your conclusions, right, are going to be reversed. So you need to remember that you reverse them if that's what you do. in my opinion, right, you never want to actually reverse kind of X and Y. If you're comparing acceleration to miles per gallon, swap miles per gallon to acceleration, right? Don't kind of switch your columns, don't switch your numbers. Instead, actually switch the unit, switch the thing itself. And that way you're less likely to be confused later because all the graphs and everything else you produce are going to be in the same format. You know, basically it'll be consistent, right? All right, so that's the correlation coefficient. When we're trying to do linear regression, what we're trying to do basically is make a line, right? So that we can estimate y. Okay, so this is kind of the goal down here, right? And so you need two things for a line. You need the slope and the intercept. And when we say the intercept, that means where it crosses zero, right? So if you have those two pieces of information, you can draw a line. It doesn't matter where the line is. So if you take the slope and multiply that by x, probably should have thought about what I was using for a character here so it wasn't so messy, but you take the slope, multiply it by x, and then add the intercept, and you will get your y. Question is, of course, how do you get to the slope? Well, so the slope is your r, right, the correlation coefficient, multiplied by the standard deviation of y divided by the standard deviation of x. Make sense? All right, and then obviously you also need the intercept. So that's the average of y minus the slope times the average of x. So obviously you do this one first because you need it for that one. And then when you have that one, then you can do this one down here. So maybe my little arrow should have gone like that, but you get the idea. Make sense? Okay. And it's a linear regression because it's a line, right? Linear. All right, so then when you want to do the estimate, and this is just kind of the same thing written in words. So you're trying to predict y by using x. So convert the given x to standard units, then multiply by r, and then that's the regression estimate of y. But it's in standard units, and you have to convert it back to the original units. You know, if you want to go back to miles per gallon, for example, it's, you know, because the standard units aren't going to be all that useful. Excuse me, if you want to, you know, come to some conclusion about those miles per gallon or whatever. Right? All right, so numerical optimization. So what this means is we're trying to, when we're doing these predictions, right, what we want to do is we want the best prediction we can get, okay? So what we do is we use a technique, right, that's referred to as numerical optimization. We'll go through it in a second. Numerical minimization is an approximate but effective way of trying to do this. And just by way of kind of for future information, right, this is a very common technique, okay, when you're doing machine learning of any kind. So that's why not only is it useful at the moment, but it's also useful because it's used for lots of other tech. It's used to try to figure out whether you're doing the right thing in lots of machine learning models or strategies, I guess. So if the function RMSE, so that's the root mean squared error, right? We'll talk about that again in a second, I think. And so what we're trying to do is return the RMSE of the estimation using the line, the estimate equals AX plus B. And you know, it's just kind of a lot of words here. So, but basically the idea is that you're trying to minimize it so that you can ensure that the line you've created, the estimate mechanism that you're using is the most accurate or most efficient. But let me show you the demo because that might make it a little clearer. All right. And being on the wrong side is going to be definitely difficult. Here we just have a bunch of functions that we're going to use. And then so we talked about this last time, but basically all we're doing here is we're pulling this demographics data out of the CSV. Then we're going to get rid of a bunch of columns we don't need so that we just have the two we care about, which is the college percentage and the median income. The primary reason we're doing that is because a couple of those columns are categorical. And so as a result, you try to scatter plot them and it's going to get angry. So we're dropping them here so that we don't have to deal with them later. Fitted values. Okay, so fitted values. Does anybody remember why we call it fitted values? I mentioned this last time, and then somebody mentioned a special kind of line. Right, so line of best fit. So think like clothing, right? You know, it has its best fit. So when it's cut correctly, then you have the best fit on clothing. So when you say something is fit, right, it usually means it's the best estimate or closest or whatever. So we tend to shorten it, right, and we start using things like fitted values. So rather than being the actual value, it's a fitted value. So if you see that, just so you know what it means. So we use this fitted value function to get predicted values based on the X, okay? And let's see, what else are we doing here? And then we do a linear prediction and put the predicted values into the table. And then we figure out the errors, and that's really what we're talking about here. But I wanted to give you a little bit of background. So when I was talking about kind of what's the method, right? It's kind of all these steps, right, to get to like a linear regression and then getting to the error. Because like, I even glossed over some of the steps, right? But there's the slope calculation, right, which goes up to the function that does the slope. So there's a lot of, all the steps are there for that kind of like how you approach a linear regression. So, we got a cool scatter plot from that one. Okay, so now what we want to do, right? Wait, one. I thought I cleared all these. No, whatever. Okay, so up here, so this was, we got the predictions, right? And then we want to look at, okay, let's look at the difference or the, we want to actually figure out like kind of how much error do we have between our predictions and the real values. So in the first case here, and we talked about this I think before already, but the first case here, we're just going to use kind of an arbitrary line, right? And this is going to give us a root mean squared error of 30,000 and some. And you can see from the red lines with some random points how far away stuff is. But then kind of going on to a few other examples. So yeah, so another example of just kind of arbitrary lines, and we still have quite a bit of error there. But if we use our real regression slope and our real regression intercept, our root mean squared error drops to 9,000, right? So that's pretty close to the best we can do. Must have forgotten to save it or something. All right, yeah, I'm gonna clear this because otherwise it's gonna be hard to talk about. Okay, so just to kind of help explain numerical optimization, okay, what we're going to do is we're going to create a line, okay, and give me this now, but here, yeah. All right, and so this is a line, well, curve, right, but a line, right, and it has that function there, so it's x minus 2 raised to the 2 plus 3. Okay, that's the calculation for the line. And so we end up with this kind of curvy looking thing here. And so what we want to do with the numerical optimization is we take, basically we create a function that returns the y value at any given x in that line, okay? So you pass in where you are on the horizontal and it'll give you back where to plot the point, essentially, okay? And so what we can do just to kind of test it is we're gonna define the function. And so, you know, the f of 2.1, which is kind of over there, right, is about 3. And sorry, I'm seeing this as a zero grid. But so yeah, it's about 3.1, right? Or three even really. So that seems about right. So we know the function looks pretty good. But then we can do 1.4 and it's kind of up there, right? So it's gonna be 3.3 or 3.4. But then we have this built-in function called minimax, okay? And that's really what we care about here, which is gonna tell you kind of the best line through it, okay? And so that's this 1.9. Trying to think of a better way to explain that. But it kind of, we can kind of use it on any line that we can draw, right? So we can have more complicated lines like this one, right? Where that's the calculation of the line. You know, it has signs in there, I mean, S-I-N. It's quite a bit more complicated. And it has that cool little curve in there, but we can continue to minimize based on it. And so basically where it's gonna kind of be the smallest point on the line, okay? So in other words, like when we're trying to optimize, right, what we're trying to do is look for the lowest point, okay? So that it's closest, if that makes sense. And so up here, right, it was 1.9, which, you know, plausible, right? It's about there. So that's the x value. And on this one, which is much more complicated, right, it's negative 0.5, which is about there. Obviously, thickness of line plays into a part. But that's kind of what the minimized function does. And so why do we care? Well, in those kinds of scenarios, it's, you know, interesting, maybe, but what we really care about is trying to minimize for the smallest root mean squared error, right? We want to know where the smallest number is so that we know what the optimal line is to do our estimations. Okay, it's kind of like you talk about in like calculus, right? Secondary derivatives, right? It's like we're getting kind of further and further and further away from the problem, because what we're trying to do is we're trying to figure out what is the optimal solution to the original problem. By, you know we need a line, so we're gonna try to figure out the errors off that line, and we're gonna try to get those errors to be smaller and smaller. And the way we do that is by reducing or by optimizing for the tightest line, et cetera, right? And so like, that's why I think part of this can be kind of confusing, because we feel like we're really far away from the real problem, but we're really not. We're just going step piece by piece to be able to calculate what is the best linear value that we can get, or the best line we can get. All right, so this is basically the same function we kind of did above, to try to directly, actually, I think it's exactly the same function, but to do the RMSE on the demographics data, looking at column, college, percentage, right, and median income, where X and Y are the appropriate ones. So then we can do an estimate, right, with the inbound slope and the inbound intercept. And then so we're going to return the mean, right, squared root. Okay, so this is our error, basically, coming out of here. So that this function is the equivalent of that depth complicated function there, because what it's going to do is it's going to return the y, okay, of this solution space. So if we just pass in kind of the arbitrary values that we're using in the graphs above, you know, just kind of any random slope and intercept, okay, we see that the minimum, we get the same value we got before, except not as a picture, we just get the straight value, right? So it's just 11,000 some odd. So then we kind of do another one that's like arbitrary. I left my tester in there. If you didn't know this already, my favorite variable to use is cow, sometimes chicken. I don't know why, but I've been doing it for a long, long time. But I wanted to break it apart so I could see what it looked like. And however, it's not showing what I really want it to show now. So let's do. Okay, so excuse me. So if I minimize that demographics RMSE, right? What I want to know is what are the two values to pass in that gives me the smallest output, right? Because I want the smallest error I can get. So what are the two inputs that I do to get that? And because I'm using a two variable method, that's why it gives me two outputs. Okay. So does anybody have a guess as to how minimize must work? Any ideas? It's really, really dumb. It tries them all. Okay. It just plugs in values until it gets the right answer. Right. So basically until it gets the lowest number. Okay. And then it tells you what those were. All right. It's slightly more sophisticated than that, but not by much. So does that make sense? Like I said, I think this is kind of confusing. So I assume y'all might find this kind of confusing, but basically what you're trying to do, you want to know what slope and intercept give me estimates that have the least amount of error. And when we say error, what that means is the root mean squared error, because if you remember from a lecture or two ago, if we just added up all the errors, right, we end up with zero because some of the errors are above and below, or we kind of end up with numbers potentially like kind of all over the place. But so in other words, so instead what we do, right, is we square them and then square root them. We square them to get to magnify further away errors, basically, and also to get rid of the messiness of negative and positive. Okay. And then ultimately we square root it so that we can get it into the same units as we were originally, because if you remember from, like I said, a lecture or two ago, when we did it without the square root, we were getting like $88 million incomes, right? Which is not common that I've seen. So we square root it so we get back into the same, you know, kind of numeric space, right? Now, what's kind of interesting, right, is that if we take our calculated slope and our calculated intercept, okay, we get the same exact number. Because, does anybody know why this is? Like, remember why we get the same number here? Because kind of taking the other approach, when we calculate the regression slope and intercept the way we were doing it before, it's the best option. It will always be the best option. Okay. So if you can calculate those things, it's going to be the best line. All right. You still have all these caveats about whether it's actually a linear correlation, you know, is it, you know, et cetera. But, you know, even my curves that I drew up there, right, is like, you can have a best line in there, right? It's just that it's error is really big most of the time, right? But it's not as big as if you had a different line, right? Which would be worse. So it's not a good estimator, but it's still better than all the other choices. Okay, using that technique. So long story short, if you can get to the slope and the intercept, you're gonna get the best answer. So obviously we're gonna get to potentially when you can't, but. So hopefully that makes sense. All right. So this is another little sidebar, but useful, I think, because what we haven't had, right, is an example of a nonlinear regression, okay? So we've talked about a bunch of linear regressions, but here's a nonlinear regression. And what this is I think this is true. Like, no, I can't remember for sure, but I think it's women shot putters, but it might be shot putters in general. I can't remember. Women? Yeah. So how much can they lift, right? Like weightlifting, okay? Versus how far their shot put distance goes, okay? In my opinion, right? Like knowing nearly nothing about shot putting or weightlifting, I would guess that the more you can lift, the further you can throw a shot put. Okay. Does everybody know what a shot put is? All right. So, you know, right? Like if you're stronger, you can lift more weight, then you should be able to throw the shot put. But in fact, what we can see here is that, you know, well, yeah, sort of, but maybe not entirely, that maybe this isn't a line, but rather a curve. Okay. And if you kind of look at it, it's a little hard to tell, you know, I like this example because it's short and sweet, but on the flip side, it looks pretty linear, right? But if you kind of look at it closely, you can tell it's not actually linear. But so, if we look at that slope and the intercept, right? And we look for, you know, we want to calculate the slope and the intercept using the weight lifted and the shot put distance, we get, you know, whatever this is, like nearly one for the slope. No, sorry, 0.01, and you know, kind of nearly six on the intercept. But so we can then kind of do the same thing we were doing before, which was looking at, okay, so we now have calculated where a line should be. Now let's look at that root mean square error to see how good a line it is. Or we can also use the minimize, because what the minimize actually works on any function, right? It doesn't care what, you know, what you're using it for. It's just gonna give you the smallest values that it can shove in there to get the smallest output. And obviously, smaller is better when it comes to error, at least in the absolute sense. So what I wanted to show you was, we are not gonna get to the other section. Well, maybe. Okay, so if we draw our linear regression or our guess, right, using a linear regression, we see there's this dotted line going through there, okay? But did we print? We haven't printed the error yet. So, but because I said before, is that if you look at it, right, it actually looks more like it's a curve. So it's probably a quadratic. Okay. So it's going to, the line calculation looks more like this rather than the line that we talked about already. And this is much harder to do on the left side than you would expect. You'd think it'd be exactly the same, but it's much more difficult. Okay, so instead, what we want to do is let's try it with a quadratic equation instead. Okay, and so here we're going to do this estimate there, versus the one we had before, which was a line, which was a slope times x plus y, or sorry, plus the intercept. And instead, we're going to use this quadratic, so it's going to be more complicated, right? It's the quadratic equation. So we can then minimize that, but now we're going to have three inputs, right? Because now we need an A, we need a B, and we need a C. Instead of just our, if you think about the slope and the intercept as A and B, right? We now need three values, right? We need an A, a B, and a C to go into that quadratic equation. So we need a minimal number, because when we run it through there, what we want to do is find what are the smallest values, or sorry, what are the values that we put in for A, B, and C that give us the smallest output, okay, when we plug it into the estimator. And so, this is just kind of an example of here, we actually do one of the predictions, but we can see if we actually use that quadratic curve, and this I was showing you before. So the yellow lines here, sorry, yellow dots here, are not a line, or not a straight line anymore. They're a quadratic curve. But it only shows up where you have X's, right? We talked about that before. So even though that's a line, it's not showing up because it only has X's. So instead, what we can do, if we want to just actually see the line, I just kind of drew that to kind of show. So this is the optimal line or curve, really, through that data set. So this should give us the best estimate for values of X when we want Y. And as you can see, up to a point, basically what it means is, like, as you can lift more weights up to a point, you keep being able to throw the shot put further. But then there's a certain point where essentially diminishing returns. You can't throw it as far, or it's not making any difference once you're past the ability to lift a certain amount of weight. And in my mind, that's actually a relatively small amount of weight. It's only 120 pounds, right? Which for somebody who does shot put, I would think is a pretty small weight to be able to lift. There's probably people in here who can lift that much. So basically, long story short, we want to be able to minimize that error. We can actually use that minimize function on lots of different scenarios. Basically, as long as we have a function, it can minimize it. And so here we did it for quadratic, but generally speaking, this is not the kind of example we're talking about in this class. We're sticking mostly with the linear regressions because, again, as I said a few lectures ago, it covers a lot of the kind of use cases that you run into. So we don't have to get into those quite yet. All right. So then, yeah, we go back to the slides, maybe. All right, so yeah, so basically it's pretty much what I just said. You know, you're trying to minimize your error. The thing is, that line, and you've probably heard me say it, right? Like, it goes by a lot of different names, okay? So these all mean the same thing, all right? It's just kind of, when you're being kind of loosey-goosey about your terminology, you kind of end up, you know, especially when it's got a really long name, people shorten it differently. So if you see kind of any of these terms, they all mean this same, linear regression line, all right? And the best fit line, which we brought up, whatever, a few lectures ago, we're finally getting to the explanation of it, but this is the line that best fits this X and Y, or the least squares line, or the regression line. The least squares line, I think, is particularly interesting because using this mechanism, the RMSE, to calculate error, it's about using the least squares, right? So when you're doing other kinds of data science, as you go kind of more in this space and you're doing things like machine learning and stuff like that, this term, I think, comes up the most. But it's a little bit of a matter of opinion. All right, so the next thing we want to talk about, let's see. Yeah, we can do some of it, I think. Okay, so the next thing we want to talk about is residuals. So did anybody, does anybody remember what remainders from like elementary school division? Okay, so the remainder is basically the part left over. And as I know you speak French, residual actually comes from a French word. Do you know what the French word is or what it means in English? Yeah, and what? Right, so it actually comes from this French word, which it just means that essentially the leftovers, right? So you see residual, it's both a bit more formal and a bit more inclusive than remainder, okay? And when I say inclusive, I mean of other kinds of use cases, not in the DEI sort of way. So residuals is what you want to call it, but I wanted to kind of explain where the term comes from. And this is where it gets a little also complicated too. So the residual corresponds to each point. So you get, you know, one leftover for each point on the line, okay? And when we're talking about these leftovers, we're primarily talking about the error, okay? So what's the bit that's left between our estimate and where it actually should be? And so we have at least three ways that we can calculate a residual, okay? So the observed y minus the regression estimate of y, this seems like the most obvious, right? So if we actually know what y is and we subtract the estimate from it, that's the residual, okay? That's the leftover, okay? And then personally, I think this is kind of like the same thing in a different way, which is the observed y, so what we know what y is, and then the height of the regression line at x. So in other words, the y, right? And then the vertical distance between the points and the best line. So it's kind of another way of saying something quite similar, okay? But so these are kind of three different ways to think about it based a little bit on the context, right? So if you have a regression line, then you might want to think about the residuals this way. Follow me? So it's almost kind of like the other thing where it's kind of different terms for the same thing. But depending on the context, you're going to kind of have more of one of these things than the others. All right. Does anybody know what a dugong is? I think I vaguely knew this when I saw it, but because I used to live in Florida. But so has anybody ever heard of a manatee? So there is I don't know actually their direct relationship, maybe subspecies of manatee. But they're very similar to a manatee. If you look at it, they actually look a lot like a manatee. But the difference, I guess, is primarily in the snout because these eat off the floor of the ocean. Why do we care? Because one of the data sets that we're going to look at now is, can we estimate the age? Oh, did I miss a demo word? Maybe. All right. So we'll talk about the dugongs in a second, maybe. But before we, basically the dugongs, can you estimate the age of the animal based on its size? So based on its length. But before we get there, we'll talk about residuals and calculating them really quickly. But I'm not sure we'll actually get to the dugongs today. By the way, dugongs are, I think, primarily in the Middle East-ish area, I want to say. But they're like endangered. There's not that many of them. But I don't think they have those in Florida. They just have manatees in Florida. Okay, so we go back to so here's our calculator for residuals, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to get our predictions, and then we're basically going to subtract the y, the predictions from the y, right? So what our actual y's are. And here's our demographics table with now our fitted values and our residuals. So basically our residuals are the error of the city of value and the should be the actual value, right? Sorry, I just want to make sure. Sorry. Okay, so we have our linear prediction, right? And we have our fitted value. And here is our residual, which is basically the diff of the fitted value and the median income, because that's our x. So, that's our y. So therefore, that's how we get to the error. And so, we can do a scatter plot. All right, and the reason we're doing this scatter plot is primarily to kind of show you what happens with the residuals, because it's almost like the opposite of doing the linear regression stuff. So we have our college percentage along the bottom, and so then we have basically the y values, our median income, which are these dark blue dots. And then the lighter blue is our fitted value as we go along it. So that tells us what is our estimated value. And then our green, we're going to kind of ignore the linear prediction for a second, but our green here is the residual, okay? And it's almost, right, like it's two different graphs, okay? And that is expected and, you know, but we want, I was kind of just putting them together to kind of see what's going on. Isn't this the same thing? Yeah, look at that. Okay. So, here they are separated, okay? So that's the top half of the graph basically up there, and then our residuals. And so what we wanna see here is that, or can anybody tell me here, what is each one of these dots? What does it represent? Right, exactly. So it's the error. Okay, so what is good about this error, in a sense, is that if you notice, it's kind of all wrapped around zero. Okay, so it's never getting too far away, and you know, kind of a little bit ignore the values here in the sense that, you know, we're talking about median income, so therefore these numbers are large, right? But when we're talking about $80,000, right, 10K is maybe not that far away. But the point is that we have a lot of distribution both on kind of the y-axis and on the x-axis that looks pretty even. So that probably means that our line is probably the best line we can do because this looks like such a blob, right? If the whole blob was like up and to the right, right, that means that our line probably isn't the best because all of the error is kind of like in the wrong place. Does that make sense? So what the information we can get from this is, hey, this looks like maybe we do have a pretty good line, okay? And we're gonna do some more calcs on that, but not today, apparently. So it's 16:45 or whatever the actual time is, 4:45 for most people. Thanks everybody, and we will see you on Thursday.